Welcome to Bloomberg ETF IQ. I'm Katie Greifeld.
And I'm Sonali Basak. I'm in for Matt Miller today. Katie, it's a yield kind of day.
It's a banks kind of day. I'm glad that you're here with us. And let's get now to the biggest stories right now in the more than $9 trillion global ETF industry. And we start with the banks. Banks of all sizes, again, in focus this week as earnings continue to roll out. We'll dig into the turmoil, how that shifted the flows and money market assets.
I'm excited also to talk about commercial real estate. It could be a huge problem area for the banks. DoubleLine, though, calls it a perfect time to launch an ETF in the space. We have an interview with a key DoubleLine money manager ahead.
And as Bitcoin surges this year, the race for the first leveraged Bitcoin ETF is heating up. We're going to have the latest a little bit later. But Sonali, as always, before we get there, Eric Balchunas from Bloomberg Intelligence, he's here with us now to look through some of the flows. Eric, what do you got?
Thank you, Katie and Sonali. It's interesting. You know, the flows are showing a little more optimism. As you know, U.S. equities have been largely ignored by ETF investors all year, which I'll go over in a minute. But in the past week, we've got SPY up there, JNK and HYG. That's definitely risk on, although on the bond side. But look, you've got Qual, that's quality stocks. VU and IVV are both S&P. XLC is communications, large cap. The majority of the top 10 is equity. We have not seen that in a while, and that's probably pretty good. Let's look at the outflows here, and I've got some more good news for you. There's a lot of cash-like ETFs, treasury ETFs at the top of the list. IEF, SPTI, SGOV, GBIL. Look, there is definitely a yield play here, but there is also some, I don't really have anything else to do with my money, I don't feel confident in U.S. equities going on as well. So when money comes out of here, I think it's good because you can see it's rotating to equities. Now let me show you what this is a contrast from what we've been seeing over the past 3 months. This is a chart my colleague Athanasios made, I love it. It's the spread between U.S. equity flows and bond flows. And you can see that spread was biggest in March 2020 when the pandemic hit, right? Everybody was scared, nobody wanted equities. It completely fell in 21. And it's creeped all the way back up to here, right? And this is, again, because people are a little scared, but they're also getting a lot of yield in some of these fixed income instruments. And if I added money market mutual funds to this, this thing would literally fly off the charts. $600 billion into those, looking for those 4.5, 4.7% yields. So Katie and Sonali, as my colleague Gina Martin,
Isn't she your boss?
Yes. I should know her name. Gina Martin Adams. She says Terra is the new Tina, and I think we're seeing it in the flows, meaning there is a reasonable alternative to equities, and we are seeing that.
Let's talk about Terra now with Amanda Rebello. She is head of Xtracker sales for U.S. onshore at DWS Group. Delighted that you're joining us in person. And Amanda, it feels like every conversation in markets right now comes back to the question of why wouldn't I just be in cash? Why wouldn't I be in some of these ultra short duration ETFs yielding 5% or so?
Exactly. We're seeing so many clients then asking the question of, I need to have some equity allocation, and where do I look for that? So I'm taking on extra risk. With cash, I can get almost 5%. So your equity is going to have to work much harder from a yield perspective. We're seeing probably strongest demand for our income suite, be it on the equity or on the fixed income side. And so on the equity side, we see a lot of interest in our international dividend suite, HDEF in particular. On the fixed income side, we see corporate defaults are relatively low versus other parts of the cycle historically. And so high yield is kind of not quite as high octane as it has been historically, but yielding with some degree of limited downside.
Yeah, I'm curious about the high yield story here a little bit, because you look at the spreads and they are not blown out to levels that you think that they would be if you were expecting a recession. At the same time, you've seen, as Katie's pointed out, tons of flows.
Yeah.
So when does that start to cap out?
I think there's still a little bit further to go. So we did see very big redemptions in Q4 last year and also the start of this year. We start to see, though, more nuanced ways to play high yield. So, you know, JNK, HYG, our own HYLB, they see some strong flows, but we also see now flows going into more esoteric high yield. So short duration high yield has been very popular. We're seeing a lot going into our own SHYL. That's yielding in the high 4%. And then we're also seeing as well interest in low beta high yield. So this is sort of tapping into the higher quality within high yield and looking at where is the price action versus where is the credit rating action, because, you know, marketers pricing in opportunities far quicker than credit agencies are. So
you talk about international dividends going over there for high yield in terms of the equities. And it's interesting, we've seen a lot of money go overseas this year.
Yeah.
Listen to this stat. International ETFs make up 28% of equity ETFs, but they're taking in 78% of equity flows.
Mm-hmm.
I'm skeptical. I just, every time international has a good like quarter, it kind of goes back to the US, I feel like. Do you think this is a regime change or just a head fake?
So Eric, maybe you have similar biases that I have, but from the other side. So I'm British, so I'm like all in favor of international equities. A couple of things. So first of all, Europe in particular was hammered last year, obviously, right? With Ukraine and with Russia, what was going on there. We were very reliant in Europe on energy sources coming from Russia, which obviously then has implications for all industrial sectors. There's kind of value a little bit implicit in European equities now. And so this has like encouraged some of the flows that we've seen more recently. But also when you think about it as well, so European equities, they tend to pay more in dividends historically than in US equities. The standard dividend yield on Eurostoxx 50, for example, is about 4% versus on the S&P is about 1.5, 1.7%. So you can look to European equities already for dividend flow. And then also, if you then seek out a specific dividend strategy on a European equity side, then you've got even more juice, above 5%, sometimes even 5.4%.
I understand the love of dividends. However, if you believe the Mike Wilson view of the world, that earnings can come down a little bit here, yeah. Or you see even more, by the way, of the banks and buybacks being paused, potentially dividends being paused, how much of a risk is there to that dividend story when you're looking at the dividend-oriented ETFs?
Yeah, so I think it's really important not to fall into the yield trap and to not just look at kind of who's been paying out in the past. You also need to look at the sustainability of the dividends going forward. And so anyone who's done the CFA obviously knows how to value a stock. It's the PV of the dividend payouts that are anticipated, and that's obviously linked to earnings and retained earnings. The challenge here, I think, is also thinking about, you don't want to have stocks which are just paying out dividends, but the capital is ultimately being eroded. And at the same time, you need to think there also needs to be some capex happening as well. So you also want stock appreciation too.
I feel like the fact that we're talking about dividends and the fact that they're in such high demand right now really speaks to this rolling bear market that we've been living in over the past year, year and a half or so. And in that rolling bear market, we've seen ETF closures pick up quite a bit. So far this year, 62 funds have closed. That's more than double last year's pace. When you look across your lineup of 39 ETFs, are you thinking at all about culling some of those funds?
So we already did some reconciliation a couple of years ago, and I think for the time being, actually, the question is which ones do we launch? So we're definitely trying to be very strategic and not just launching things for the sake of them. I think the figure that we typically have in our minds is a fund going to be viable enough and relevant enough for as many investors as possible that we can think about $1 billion AUM threshold? Because we all know that ETFs have a very good cost efficiency, but you typically need to get above a certain level, and we would like to still be providing clients, not just with innovation and access, but also with value too.
Great place to leave it. Amanda, really appreciate your time coming to see us on set. That is Amanda Rebello of DWS Group. And coming up, with Bitcoin back around $30,000, the race for the first leveraged Bitcoin ETF is heating up. That conversation up next. This is ETF IQ on Bloomberg. Welcome back to Bloomberg ETF IQ. I'm Katie Greifeld. Time now for the ETF Brief, where I walk you through the trends and the stories that caught my eye in the ETF industry. And we start with some leaky oil ETFs. You're looking at the four biggest oil ETPs on the market. I know that there's a lot of colors on this chart. Those colors represent the fund flows into these four different funds. And as you can see, for four straight weeks, we've posted net outflows from this group. That is the biggest cumulative streak going back to July. So clearly investors souring a little bit on oil ETPs. At the same time, you see demand picking up for junk bond ETFs. You're looking at HYG and JNK here. These are two of the largest junk bond ETFs. And last week, on a single day, they brought in nearly $2 billion. That is the biggest combined inflow going back to November. So clearly, investors may be warming up to the idea that the Fed could pivot, they could pause, and that would be good for junk bond ETFs. Let's also talk about Bitcoin, because why not? You're seeing a little bit of a race launch here. You can see that three issuers in about 3 weeks have filed for leveraged Bitcoin futures ETFs. These would be two times the performance of an index of Bitcoin futures. Sonali, I feel like we've been here before.
We have certainly been here before. They can't get a spot
ETF done, so why not lever up the existing ones?
Yeah, why not? Or at least let's try. Let's talk about this now with Bloomberg's Vildana Heirich joining us on set. Vildana, we've seen issuers try to file for these products before and then ultimately withdraw those filings. Why would this time be different?
That's a really good question. I'm just thinking about how you just, like a professional, said three times leveraged Bitcoin futures ETF. Say that like 10 times fast. It's impossible. But the filings are landing at a really good time, so it's really, really difficult to actually time these things so precisely. Obviously, these applications have been in the work for months or for however long, but they're coming at a time when cryptocurrency prices are rallying. So there's new excitement that's been building around cryptocurrencies over the last couple of months just because prices have been rallying so much. Bitcoin started around $16,600 at the start of the year. Right now, it's hovering around $30,000. So, you know, when strategists or analysts or whoever is looking at this, they're thinking, okay, the timing around this is looking pretty good.
I think the question with Bitcoin is always, do you buy Bitcoin? Do you buy a product around Bitcoin? How do the futures products do in the ETF form relative to what we've seen people trade in other fashions?
Yeah, so we have the Bitcoin futures ETF that's been around since October 2021. That caused a lot of excitement when those first came out. And Katie and I have written about this in the past. It actually, the products have been tracking the price of Bitcoin very closely. So there had been worries that there would be sort of, you know, a gap between what how those ETFs actually perform and how Bitcoin performs, but they've actually been tracking pretty closely. This obviously is very different. It's like a super juiced
double, triple return.
Exactly. But we do have to remember, because crypto prices have been rallying so much this year, crypto ETFs are actually the top performing ETFs out of the US equities ETFs universe.
Right. Well, that's the thing. You can see number two on that list is the VanEck Digital Asset Mining ETF. That's actually shutting down.
It's closing. That's
Why?
Right. It was up something like 120, 130% for the year, but there's been so little follow through in terms of flows. So each of these top performing Bitcoin, you know, Bitcoin-centric or crypto-centric equity ETFs have actually seen very, very little flows, like maybe two or three sessions worth of flows over the last year, which is just...
That's the thing. You can build it. Will they come? So far, they haven't. Yeah, right. Will they actually launch and will people actually buy it? Remains to be seen. This was Sublime. Vildana Heirich, thank you so much. And now we're going to turn to an ETF that has not performed as well as Bitcoin in 2023. This one is focused on defensive stocks. Take a look.
The Invesco Defensive Equity ETF, also known by its ticker DEF, seeks large cap names with superior risk return profiles. Fund's aim, build a wall during periods of stock market weakness while still offering the potential for gains in times of market strength. DEF consists of 100 names that are equal weighted. Its stocks are selected from the S&P 500 using a rules-based quantitative approach that measures each holding, odds of maintaining revenue growth, beta, and down market volatility. Names include Electronic Arts, Procter & Gamble, Kimberly-Clark, United Health, and Walmart. DEF holds some $240 million in assets and costs 53 basis points. Since launching in 2006, its returns have closely tracked the S&P 500, except for a slight divergence during the pandemic. Over the past year, it has outpaced the benchmark index. DEF gets a green light in the Bloomberg Intelligence traffic light system with one warning for its alternative weighting.
Still ahead on ETF IQ, we're going to drill down into commercial real estate with Morris Chen of DoubleLine Capital and why he thinks now is the perfect time for a real estate ETF. That conversation coming up next. This is ETF IQ on Bloomberg.
This is Bloomberg ETF IQ. I'm Sonali Basak alongside Katie Greifeld.
And Eric Balchunas from Bloomberg Intelligence. He's back with us now for today's drill down where we focus on one ETF. Eric, hit it.
Katie, thank you. Today we're going to look at the DoubleLine Commercial Real Estate ETF. The ticker is DCMB. This thing is hot off the press. It just came out. So if you look at the inception date, the end of March, 39 basis points is the fee. That, to me, is pretty low for active. You can see it's actively managed. And that's really the differentiator here. This is a small category, but here's an active fund. And DoubleLine is going to go out and invest in commercial mortgage-backed securities for you. And you can see the holdings here. These are going to be connected. These are bonds that are connected to a diverse group of commercial properties, right? So this is basically investing in all the commercial real estate out there. But again, DoubleLine is picking through the bonds for you. Let's look at the, there's not a lot of return to look at, but we'll look at the return versus what I think is probably the benchmark. So in this category, iShares has CMBS, which charges 25 bips, so a little cheaper. It's the sort of passive option. And so I think DoubleLine is going to try to have to beat this to sort of draw in some flow. So far it is, but we're very, very early. But again, if this these kind of returns continue, Katie Schnally, I think this thing should get some looks, especially considering the low fee.
Eric, thank you. And joining us now is DoubleLine's Morris Chen, who manages this fund. And Morris, like Eric just walked through, this launched just a couple of weeks ago, really in the eye of the storm of commercial real estate. And you told me last week that now is the perfect time to launch a commercial real estate ETF. Why is that?
Yeah, I mean, amidst a lot of the uncertainties, we're seeing headlines on a week over week and even almost daily basis in terms of commercial real estate, whether it's defaults, whether it's, you know, concerns surrounding maturity walls. And I think a lot of that has, you know, caused a lot of concern, underlying concern and uncertainty within the commercial mortgage bond market. As a function of that, you know, we've seen prices reset and reprice to the tune where we're veering towards some of the highs in terms of spread widening that we saw during March of 2020, back when the pandemic first started.
Well, Morris, to the point that this is an actively managed ETF, when you look through all the dislocations that have come up in the commercial real estate market as a result of what we're seeing, where do you see the most opportunity right now?
Yeah, I mean, you know, again, we're definitely not out of the clear with respect to, you know, what's going on. The Fed is engineering a somewhat of an economic slowdown. So for us, you know, focusing at the upper echelons of the investment grade capital structure within the CMBS arena, we think there's a lot of relative value. Just, you know, given the principal protection that you're afforded, this is a debt investment. I would kind of highlight that. And this is a market that, you know, has repriced.
Mm-hmm. Morris, I'm really curious, when you look out there with all the concerns about this market in particular, what kind of securities won't you touch?
Yeah, you know, for us, we're, you know, there are, you know, securities that are a little bit heavier in office product. You know, clearly there's a lot of concern surrounding the office property type. So, you know, we're eyes wide open. We will try to underwrite every single underlying loans that underlying these transactions. You know, clearly office is a concern. So for us, you'll probably see us be underweight the office sector. That's not to say that we're going to avoid it all intuitively or in totality. There are opportunities out there in segments, you know, and we'll try to dig through it. And that's part of our job as an active manager.
So, Morris, a lot of people own bonds through the aggregate bond index, the Bloomberg Ag. I was surprised. CMBS is only 1.7% of that index. I guess you're going to make the case that it should be a little more. Or you're more making the case that it's a timing thing. Now is the time for CMBS. You ride it for a while, and then you get out.
Yeah, I think there's a case for a long-term exposure to the commercial mortgage bond sector. It is a diversifier versus corporate credit. I do think, you know, as we're kind of thinking about the index, I would highlight that the index also excludes a lot of, you know, subsectors within CMBS, such as commercial real estate CLOs, such as single asset, single borrower, commercial mortgage-backed securities. And these subsectors, given that they're excluded, they do represent a larger portion of the CMBS market, especially over the last 5 years, and the market continues to evolve. So for us, you know, thinking about the index and thinking about our specific ETF, this is a, you know, it's a way for investors to get exposure to what I think is the present day CMBS market. It's a little different.
And Morris, one of the big concerns that we hear about a lot as it relates to the CRE market right now is the maturity wall that you mentioned. And there's various estimates for how big that wall actually is in the next few years, but they all sound scary. When you think about that looming maturity wall, how real of a concern is that for this market?
You know, I think there's valid concerns if you look at the data. But as you look at the underlying makeup in terms of the commercial mortgage maturity wall, there are a lot of different lenders that are out there, whether it's life insurance companies, whether it's commercial banks, The CMBS market is a source of financing as well. So for us, it's not an easy answer to say that, you know, simplistically speaking, loans will not refinance. There are options. Now, the caveat is borrowing costs has gone up materially for borrowers, and that's something that borrowers will need to face.
I'm wondering, speaking of that also, I mean, speaking of borrowers here, they're only as kind of healthy as the CMBS market, the securitization market is, and there are a lot of criticisms here about supply. Are you finding supply coming from other areas that keep the market kind of healthy enough to invest in over the next several years?
Yeah, you know, the CMBS market does a pretty good job in terms of adapting to market conditions. This year, there was a 5-year fixed rate loan program, which inherently was introduced to the market, and as a function of that, you know, we're definitely seeing transactions come through as an investor to see that this new product flow through, and I think that again, that's a different option for borrowers. So, you know, I think through evolution in terms of market conditions, we'll definitely see the creation of unique products. Commercial real estate CLOs is another example of a CMBS financing tool that affords borrowers an option, given the pullback in terms of financing options out there.
Morris, got to leave it there. Really, really appreciate your time. Of course, that is Morris Chen of DoubleLine Capital. And if you just can't get enough of ETFs, a reminder that you can listen to Eric and Joel Weber on Trillions. Of course, that is their bi-weekly podcast that covers the industry. One of the latest programs, the latest episode, it features this very show, Eric.
It does. You're on a lot. You're like a regular recurring guest, but this one had Matt and you. We played some clips from the first year. We had a good time. You know, TV's pretty quick. This, you get to loosen up a little more and get to meet Matt and Katie, I think, a little bit better. I think people will like it.
No, you should listen.
Oh, I'm a big fan of all three people on the podcast, by the way, too. But, you know, also a big theme this year is the money market funds.
Oh, yeah.
I love listening to you guys really, you know, close the loop there.
That did come up on the podcast, believe it or not.
Active
money market funds, ESG. Jeppy, yeah,
what?
We covered a lot of bases.
We did, Tara, Tina, all of it. Definitely worth a listen, of course. That is Trillions. That's the podcast. This is Bloomberg ETF IQ, the television show. That does it for us for now. I'm Katie Greifeld, along with Eric Balchunas and Sonali Basak, and this is Bloomberg.